is the leader within the realm of angels and serves as a warrior to defeat the forces of evil over the thrones. But did you know that Archangel Michael is only mentioned a total of 6 times in the Bible? He is mentioned 3 times in the Old Testament, in Daniel, where he is mainly mentioned by another entity, and later again in the New Testament, in his battle with Lucifer and the other fallen angels. He's also seen in the Epistle of Jude in the debate of Satan, and is again alluded to in the first epistle of the Thessalonians, though he is not explicitly named in this instance. In all of these accounts, though, the scripture supporting Archangel Michael is loose at best. And as I mentioned earlier, perhaps this is where the fascination with angels stems from, in that the Bible does not tell us much about this bold and brilliant persona. Archangel Michael's first mention comes out of the Old Testament in the book of Daniel, and it is virtually just that, a mention. Daniel, son of the God, prays to his Lord in hopes that he will bring some stability to the turmoil in Israel, and hopes to confess all of the sins of his people. During this prayer, a being makes himself known, and is described in Daniel 10:5-6 as a man dressed in linen, with a belt of fine gold and new belts around his waist. His body was like topaz, his face like lightning, his eyes like flaming torches, his arms and legs like the gleam of burnished bronze, and his voice like the sound of a multitude. While this man is never explicitly identified, it is understood that this being is not mortal, and that he is of a supernatural position. His presence in Daniel 10:10-20 sees this entity explain to Daniel what will happen to his people, what lies in Israel's fate in the times coming. What's most interesting about these passages is that the entity, powerful as he appears to be, claims that he has been resisted by the prince of Persia, and that this has delayed him in reaching Daniel. In Daniel 10:13, he states that the prince of the Persian kingdom resisted me for 21 days. Then Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me. While the nature of Michael's help is not detailed beyond this, we can gather that the entity in question is reinforced by Michael, thus on the side of God. The fact that Michael came to help this entity shows us perhaps the basis of which his reputation as a protector stems from. Michael's involvement at all also serves to show Daniel that the entity which has approached him is on God's side, for Michael works only with God's divine intentions in mind. Some have speculated that this entity is actually Archangel Gabriel, another of the suspected archangels in religious scripture, most notably Judaism. But many dispute this idea, as this figure is never addressed as Gabriel in this chapter. Previously, Daniel hears Gabriel's voice in chapter 8, verse 16, when Daniel is having a vision. He says, "And I heard a man's voice from the eunuch calling, 'Gabriel, tell this man the meaning of the vision.'" In the next verse, Gabriel speaks and says, "Son of man, what he said to me, understand that the vision concerns the time of the end." Furthermore, Gabriel actually appears before Daniel in chapter 9, verse 21, where Daniel explains, "Gabriel, the man I had seen in the earlier vision, came to me in swift flight about the time of the evening sacrifice." So if the entity speaking of Michael was actually Gabriel, then Daniel should have recognized him, instead of being overcome by the sheer awe of him, where he is noted as trembling with his hands and knees. Unless, of course, as some have suggested, Gabriel has only shown himself to Daniel in a lesser form, and when he appears to him again in chapter 10, he comes as his true self, hence why Daniel only chooses now to describe the entity's appearance. All in all, though, the reference of Gabriel as a man in the title of the chapter, Daniel's Vision of a Man, seems to indicate that this is not Gabriel, and while obviously otherworldly, is merely a messenger bringing word of Michael. By the end of their encounter in 10:20-21, the entity further confirms their allegiance with Michael by saying, "Do you know why I have come to you? Soon I will return to fight against the prince of Persia. When I go, the prince of Greece will come. But first I will tell you what is written in the book of truth. No one supports me against him, except Michael, the prince." By calling Michael Daniel's prince, it highlights his importance and gives us something of an inkling that Michael harnesses some sort of higher power, that he should be respected and revered by Daniel, and therefore Daniel's people. this, we can't do much more than speculate. The prophecy is finally concluded in chapter 12, and the writer is brought up one last time, his final mention in the entirety of the Old Testament, where the entity explains, Michael, the great prince who protects your people, will arise. There will be a time of distress, such as has not happened from the beginning of nations until then. But that is not alone, defining Michael. His eyes like flaming torches, his arms and legs like a gleam.